Welcome to this video. If we're meeting for the first time, my name is Tasos Koidis and I'm a lecturer in Food Science and Nutrition at Queen's University Belfast. Follow this channel to learn about food science and nutrition, improve your food choices and ultimately improve your health. Last week in part one, we focused on the ingredients list. If you didn't have the chance to see it yet and you want the full picture, pause this video now, click in the description down below or in the card on the top right corner of your screen, and then come back here to watch it again. Otherwise, stick with me for a deep dive into how to decode the nutritional table of everyday foods, including many, many examples. Hang around until the end because I'm going to be revealing the number one secret of food labels in relation to calorie counting that will blow your mind. So let's go. I was always fascinated by the food labels. I remember looking at the Kellogg's cornflakes box every morning during breakfast and trying to get sense of what is going on with those strange words in them. But how can we make sense of what is listed in the nutritional table? You need to remember that all foods contain the same things, and these are fats. Some of them would be saturated fats, and some of them would be unsaturated fats. High saturated fat diet might give you long-term problems. The next thing is carbohydrates. And again, some of the carbohydrates could be sugars, and the rest are just non-sugar carbohydrates. For example, starch, bread, pasta, oats. These are polysaccharides, but they are not sugars. The next thing is protein. Protein from animal origin, it could be eggs, meat, or it could be from plant origin, legumes, nuts, and so on. Fiber, which is non-digestible material, and water. All foods will have actually quite a lot of water, unless they are dry. So these are the fundamentals. These are the essential food components that all the foods in the world would contain. Some people in the fitness space would actually call these things macros, which is short for macronutrients. The nutritional table, however, contains salt, which is a non-essential ingredient. Is not a food component per se, but the thing is that most of the pre-packaged foods have it. Just because, let's be honest, it's awesome, super, super tasty. But also it's not very good for you. Keep in mind that the lower salt levels actually help you avoid high blood pressure and risking of cardiovascular diseases. It is often hidden in everyday foods. So now you see why it deserves a place in the nutritional table. All of these components, including salt, they will have reference intakes, RIs. Just look at the figure now. These are based on a healthy adult consuming 2000 calories daily as an average figure. The reference intakes are not intended to be used as targets because energy requirements and nutrient requirements are different for different people, but they provide a nice, a useful indication. Now, the combination of the reference intake for all the food components and the calories per serving create a simple percentage, which is a metric of how costly this food is towards your caloric intake and the macronutrients. For example, if you eat a bag of crisps and it contains 50% RI of salt, you just consumed half of your daily intake in salt. So know that, because the rest of the day you can keep your choices when it comes to salt very low. Speaking of calories, one thing we didn't discuss yet is that the table provides, of course, the amount of calories of the food per 100 grams and usually per portion. And we talk about single servings. Now, there's a lot to be said for portions, because in this country, and I would say in most countries, we have a problem with portion size and knowing what a portion size should be. Let me tell you, it's usually a lot less than what you think. Take a pasta dish or rice, for example. You will be surprised if I tell you that this only is 75 grams, and that's per person, that's a serving. Many of us will go overboard with our serving portions. Best advice I have for you, use one of these nice food scales, the best 15 pounds investment you can make for your diet. Links in the description down below to purchase one and support the channel in no extra cost for you. The idea is that the nutritional table and all the macros, carbohydrates, protein, sugars, are broken down per 100 grams and are broken down per portions, so that you will know how much of everything you are getting in each portion. The 100 grams figure is usually very useful for comparison purposes between different foods. Some important points I would like to make before I reveal the number one secret of food labels. Calories are not king. All calories are not equal because of the way food is cooked. For example, the food label in pasta might give you the raw pasta in 100 grams, but when you boil it, the pasta releases protein and carbohydrates and absorbs water. So the nutritional composition of the cooked pasta and its calories are going to be completely different from the raw pasta. Some manufacturers are giving you the calorie breakdown of the cooked product, citing it as cooked as per instruction and not the nutritional information of the product as solved, or the other way around. But the best manufacturers are giving you both. How do we know if a particular food is within its product category is healthy? Take yogurts. You have a natural yogurt and you have a flavored yogurt dessert. How can you tell in a glance which one is better option? Enter the traffic light system, which is just a super convenient way to communicate both the macronutrient profile of the food per serving and its impact towards the recommended intake. There is nothing like it really when it comes to comparing foods, and you will see very quickly here on the screen why the natural yogurt is actually superior to any flavored yogurt because of the added sugar. But how the macros are coded exactly in the traffic light system? Green labels mean that the food is low in one of the above, so it will be the healthiest choice. Amber means medium, which is fine as part of a balanced diet, but red means that the food is high in something, for example sugar or salt, so try not to eat as much of that as possible. Now the same system is designed to be used in the front of the pack labeling here in the UK, and I know that not all products have this information because it is still voluntary for food businesses to opt in. So it is good to have an independent measuring stick to compare stuff around in case your product doesn't have it. Here is where the label decoder system is handy. This is a pocket-sized guide that you can screenshot on your mobile phone and you can use it when you shop around. In fact, do this right now if you can. If your food product has front of pack label, use it. And if not, use this decoder. They are working on the same principle. But just one thing, in both cases, be mindful of the portion size, because very easily you can start underestimating macros quite a lot and you will end up gaining weight fast. Now, drum roll for the big reveal. Food labels are amazing. And they can be super informative, yes, to provide us with actionable information about our diet, if we know how to decode them. However, have you considered how accurate they are? You will be surprised to know that the law allows for the food businesses to be plus or minus 20% off from the numbers that they feature in their label. Shocking? 20%, as in 250 calories more or less daily, which you can be either gaining weight or losing weight on a consistent basis, because they are enough. Why they are so inaccurate? Why they differ so much in reality? Why this is allowed it to begin with? They have factored in for variability to account for changes in the raw material suppliers and in the processes that are used in the factory. And the label is printed once, remember, and can be used for several days, months, or even sometimes years. Whereas the raw material composition, it just fluctuates. Which if you think about it, it makes sense. However, 10% will make more sense to me. 20% seems too generous. But when you're in restaurants and coffee shops, it's even worse. Over there, they do provide calorie breakdowns, maybe, for a steak or a muffin in a coffee shop. And the value can be a whopping 50% off to account for change of ingredients, for the way of cooking, 50% off. So please, try not to count calories. Just rely on common sense, make reasonable food choices, and control your portion sizes. And that was it. Like, share, subscribe, and stay tuned for the summer edition of this channel featuring Greece, local foods, their people, their culture. Thanks a lot, and see you next time. Bye!